Welcome back, you're watching NewsX. My name is Vineet Malhotra. Describing the Chinese military's activities in the region as destabilizing, U.S. Secretary of Defense Mark Esper said America was very closely monitoring the situation between India and China along the line of actual control. Esper made the remarks while addressing a virtual security seminar amid China's renewed military assertiveness in eastern Ladakh as well as in the South China Sea. The U.S. says it is pleased to see both sides are trying to de-escalate the situation. Asserting that the People's Liberation Army activities in the region are destabilizing, the U.S. says that China continues its aggressive behavior in the East and the South China Sea more predominantly. The U.S. has time and again reiterated that America's relationship with India is one of all-important defense relationship of the 21st century. A lot happened today between America and China. In fact, a lot of drama is being played out in the back channels as well, apart from what we get to see in terms of optics from China and the United States. A lot of tit-for-tat activity is going on between these two countries. And joining me on this debate is Ambassador Basmati Mukherjee, former diplomat, Major General Shashi Astara, former additional DG Infantry, Global Strategic and Defense Analyst, Sumit B, political analyst, also joins us. Sumit, good to see you. And Joyta Basu, editor of the Sunday Guardian. General Astana, let's start with you. Speak of America saying that they are happy with the process which has been made when you talk about de-escalation between India and China. Well, the US can be happy, but we are still not happy with the progress that has been made by at least China when it comes to retreating from the land that is obviously unequivocally ours.
Certainly, we are not happy, and the present situation certainly needs to be taken to the conclusive end, and they have to get out of the territory which they have occupied, which was not supposed to be occupied as per CBMs, and they must get back to pre-standoff positions. As far as USA is concerned, in addition to what the Defense Secretary has said, a new development has also taken place that the National Defense Authorization Act has been passed by their House of Representatives, and that also mentions Ladakh. And therefore, the statement of the Defense Secretary to say that India-US partnership is one of the biggest security partnership of this century, I think stands to play to credentials. Secondly, this is also a testing time for us as far as a strategic partnership with the United States is concerned. Certainly, till today, I think United States is doing everything which is expected to be done. We expect from United States certainly intelligence, help in military hardware, and most importantly, in the maritime domain, that is the exercises which we are doing. They indicate that, yes, they are committed towards maritime domain. We also want to remind China that they have a vulnerability in Indian Ocean. Their entire supply routes, they pass through this region. And therefore, if they are thinking that they are not vulnerable, or they have amassed a fair amount of military hardware in the Eastern Seaboard, there is a vulnerability which is lying elsewhere. All their bases in Indian Oceans can be blockaded if India and US decide to do so at any point of time. And their supply lines are as vulnerable as they think that they could perhaps squeeze South China Sea and make it a Chinese lake. So therefore, I am very sure that US is walking the talk. US also had a lot in stake, because there was a red line laid by United States that if China tries to change the status quo of Taiwan unilaterally, then it will be a red line. And therefore, if the PLA is talking and if the Chinese leadership is talking about that, I think they are also hinting at the red line being crossed. So I think there is a lot happening, and we will have to wait and see. As far as our borders are concerned, we will have to perhaps take it on ourselves, and we are mentally prepared to do whatever we can in the national interest. And this week also happens to be the week of Kargil Divas, and we have not forgotten as to how we have fought Kargil war. And certainly, we do not mind for a longer standoff, for a longer tug of war, if that situation arises, and ready for all kinds of eventualities.
Ambassador Mukherjee, you know, really a day goes by, you know, when you talk about barbs and accusations or actions which are being taken between China and the United States. It's a surreal and an unprecedented environment. You think that there's going to be a chasm created between these two countries, which is going to be too deep to fill, you know, maybe for years to come now.
I think there is bipartisan support, Vineet, in the United States for a more muscular policy against China within the United States. And the United States, when it says that the relationship, the defense relationship with India is the most important as far as US is concerned in the 21st century, it's conveying also a very important signal to China that in a moment of crisis, the United States will stand with India. The military exercises that were conducted by the naval fleet on their way back from the South China Sea, again with our Navy, gave a very important signal that the United States considers India to be a major maritime power, a major factor for peace and security in the Indo-Pacific, and that the Quad and the United States will stand with India. So these are very important issues, because it is important to understand that the threat to India from China is not only on its northern border, but it is also in the ocean. As far as the northern border is concerned, I agree with General Asthana that since I don't think the PLA intends to use its nuclear weapons against us in the northern border, it's going to be a conventional border war if there is one, and there we will give right back as good as we get. The de-escalation which is taking place, I have to say, on the Chinese side is taking place in a very half-hearted manner. A lot of pressure and push will be required both from us and from the Americans and from others in order to make that de-escalation complete. They are de facto still on our territory. So regardless of what we say officially about talks, etc., intense pressure will have to be brought on them to make them vacate. So all in all, Vineet, it is very heartening to know that the Americans have said this and that there is bipartisan support. So I don't agree with those cynics who say that once the elections are over in the United States, they may sing a different tune, because this has bipartisan support. It doesn't matter who is in the White House. This particular aspect of US policy is not going to change. That is my assessment.
Right. Sumit, you know, Beijing thinks that Washington is bent on containing China's you know, superpower status, and they feel that their rightful position under the sun of being a superpower has been denied to them by the United States. And you know, we've spoken about this on a number of occasions on this platform as well, that the you know, that the geopolitical designs of China were exactly what the world is being exposed to. You know, they want to own everything, they want to penetrate everywhere, but the US does not find any fancy to that, and that had to break down sometime or the other. And coincidentally, you know, it's come at a time, it's juxtaposed at a time when the corona pandemic has also sort of taken the world by storm, and America clearly blames China for it.
Hey, Vinny, thanks for having me on the show. The point here is that there are three, four things which, you know, the Mark mentions today. One is that he's talking for Indo-Pacific Command, so the people already talked about, then the joint exercise. But he mentioned a very important thing, Vinny. He said that we have to factor in a new combination of Russia and China coming together. And both these regimes are revolutionist. Mark my word, revolutionist in nature. That means, you know, using violence, using all kinds of tactics, you know, turning the governments and all, that is a part of the revolution. The problem is that with both these, China and Russia, especially, you know, with Chinese, they believe in ideology. Now, PLA does not work or have loyalties to the Republic of China. PLA has loyalties to a CCP, Chinese Communist Party, which is basically ideology. So it's not like Indian Army, which has loyalty to the motherland. So that is makes a hell of a difference. Now compare PLA with the Jaish-e Mohammed. Jaish-e Mohammed also is an identity, you know, loyalty to identity. You talk of Hezbollah, they talk of, you know, ideology. So this is a very dangerous combination. And with China really trying to do what it's trying to do, the biggest threat is not from Iran today, the biggest threat is not from Iraq today, is this communist regime. And honestly, Vineet, you see what is happening in the world. I would like to bring a very important factor. These ultra-leftists, which is basically China, is getting hold of Islamists, and a new kind of world is facing a new kind of a challenge. I call it the Red Jihad. You know, this red extremism is a combination of left and Islamist forces, which can really wreak havoc in the world. So it is important for United States of America and us, for anybody, before this red terrorism, Red Jihad, whatever you want to call it, takes on the whole world, we stop the red connection to it. We have to cut the Chinese influence, because their intentions, their belief is clear. It's not a question of we need. It starts from economy, it goes to politics, then it goes to ideology. From ideology, it goes to ethnicity. Don't forget this famous technique of DNA engineering.
Sumit, you have time and again also brought in and named a certain individual by the name of Goebbels.
Yeah.
And the Third Reich and the Nazi Party, and their ambitions to have a 1,000-year regime. You think China is also perhaps alluding, to such a system?
They have taken that leaf, not from Shinzo, from Goebbels. Is like to, because a lot of things what you talk about China is 90% is propaganda, and they want their people to believe that it is Chinese, it is the Han Chinese race which is going to rule the whole world. So you have to support us. The Chinese economy might be in shambles with $50 trillion of debt. Incidentally, 88 trillion is the global GDP, and 55% of that is Chinese debt, while as our debt is 1.7 trillion. We're not going to that right now. With so much of debt, and there, you know, everything is, for last 15-20 years, they are controlling RMB. RMB is not fluctuating as per the market. With all these things happening, what can they sell to the people? They can only sell to the people will capture the whole world, and people like you and me, if we are Chinese, you and me will own a province. That is the dream they are selling to them. And let me tell you, we need to do, for China to have an economy of this size is a compulsion, because you have 1.4 billion people. And your system of economy is not sustainable. It is based on, government decides, who does what, who owns what. Why should a private enterprise come in a communist regime? So you have been going and selling to US, you made all the money. But now your problem is, even you're not happy with that. Now say, okay, we will capture the whole world. I mean, there is something which is wrong in your mind. What do you mean by capturing the whole world? There is no scope for that today. Russia could not take a small place called Crimea. The hell broke loose. How on this earth could you kind of think of getting the whole world? Let me take you one point, Vineet, last point. There was one Emperor Tang, what did he do? He disbanded, if you read the history, he disbanded all the Chinese Navy, because he told them, if you have a Navy, you'll go and attack the world. You will want to take the whole world. Let's get rid of all the Chinese Navy. So you know, China traditionally did not have a Navy, because they believed if somebody comes to attack us, we'll defend. So it is something
let me also get an opening remark from Joyita Basu. Sumit, you very categorically said that the plan of China was to rule the entire world, but they've ended up infecting the entire world. Joyita, the US-China trade and tech wars, do you think they are symptomatic of a deeper and more dangerous geopolitical divide, which is perhaps rooted in their contrasting political systems?
In the contrasting political systems, of course, that is very much a case, because you see, China is an authoritarian system, and US, in spite of all the problems it has, and all, it's actually a democracy. It's basically, in its essence, China is also trying to prove that its system is better. In fact, if you have been following whatever the kind of discourse that is coming out and the kind of discourse that it is trying to sell its people, it's about how well we have managed the coronavirus situation, for example. You see, and look at the way, in fact, just today I was reading some tweet by Global Times saying that, so many soldiers have got coronavirus, the border security force, so many soldiers in the US have got coronavirus. It's all about how we are better at controlling the situation. And it is always telling their people that, you see, your system is better. We may not allow you to protest. We may not allow you to, they have issues with the government. You may not, but at least you are living in a better system. You are better. You are more prosperous. You see, having said that, you see, also what's going on here is that China is trying to carve the world into a G2 system, a group of two, where it is a straight contest between the US and the China. there are two groupings in the world. One will be led by the US and the other will be led by China. So the whole point is, you see, each and every of China's policies, if you look at it, it is actually all directed at US. It is all about gaining superpower status. In fact, that is the world's number one superpower, and that is the reason why it has been going around spreading money, you know, taking control of institutions. But China being China, very sooner I would say it has happened than later, it has shown its real face, you see, and it is a very malign face. China is a malign power. You know, there's a comparison. I mean, there are colonialism in China, there's authoritarianism, a singular lack of moral compass. So China is actually the true manifestation of what we can call a malign power. And also it's a China, the way, if you're going to talk about the propaganda part of it, propaganda is just a post-truth situation. I mean, it's lies, lies and lies. Until you keep lying, it becomes the truth. So it's basically a post-truth scenario. That is what China is trying to present to the rest of the world.
General Astana, do you think that China's economic success has perhaps, created a bubble for them where they are eclipsed by reality? They think that their economic success is also equal to their military success, especially against countries like India and the United States. But, you know, it reminds you of another situation, like what happened to Germany in World War I and how they were made to, in fact, go down on their knees when they overestimated their might but underestimated the might of the opposition and the countries. You think China is perhaps heading in the same direction, sir?
Certainly, you have picked up a right example. Whenever the ambition and the dream goes beyond the capacity, the regime as well as the country suffers and it moves towards the disaster. Now, in case of China, what has happened is, they were looking to be superpower by 2049 and a developed society. That was the aim listed by China. But with the COVID-19, they preponed everything and they made an unfair use of COVID-19 to try and resolve their dream. At the same time, economically, they have done all kinds of fudging which can be done on this earth. And with some of the estimates, their debts are 307% of their GDP. So basically, the checkbooks, the checks which they are cutting all over the world to various people, those checks will never get cashed. That is the reality of the situation. The second thing is that they are into information warfare, as Joyta pointed out. And this information warfare, they want to actually give out true face of China and tell all lies. There is a three warfare strategy, as it is called, in which one of the pillar is that try and justify every action of CCP internally as well as outside. That is the legal part of it. And the media and propaganda campaign are the other two. So that is another thing. Third thing which I want to point out is China's strategy has moved from initially active defense towards incremental encroachment, and now it is a chaotic China which is the aggressive strategy. And secondly, I couldn't answer that in your last show, that was two island chains. Actually, China never used to think beyond their eastern seaboard, and they always felt that US has hemmed them into the first island chain and the second island chain. Now they thought that now from a brown water navy, they have become a blue water navy, so they can cross the first island chain, and having crossed, then they can perhaps cross the second island chain. They forget that even till today, 80% of their trade still has to pass through Malacca Strait, irrespective of CPEC, which is not viable as of now. Even the China-Myanmar economic corridor will have to pass through Bay of Bengal, which can be choked. So they can be choked anywhere. And thirdly, the wrong estimation is USA in last 20 years has put 4 times the defense budget than China, and therefore the US power can never be underestimated. They will not give a walkover on Taiwan. So what has happened is, because they have been able to enmasse certain things on eastern seaboard, they feel confident in eastern seaboard or South China Sea, but they forget that they can be pulled out. The moment their traffic in Indian Ocean is blocked, China will have no option but to come and fight. And anywhere outside, they are no match to US Navy. So therefore, the strategy gaming is totally different. They are not there to fight. They are only to do propaganda. And by that propaganda, if they gain something, like because of by this propaganda, if Indians now keep quiet, what is going to happen is they will maintain a status quo. And in that case, perhaps we may be a loser because they would have taken the strategic piece, which they were not supposed to be there as per the CBMs. I won't say it is my territory, his territory, because LAC is not defined. So that's a controversial issue because it has not been defined. But they are trying to change the LAC. So these are the things which are coming up.
Yeah, absolutely. So, just a minute left into our conversation. Ambassador Mukherjee, we all remember the Cold War era. We are in fact on the verge or on the cusp of entering a similar atmosphere, but this time one country remains the same, but the other one is replaced by China.
I just wanted to add actually, Vineet, very quickly, that in addition to what General Astana said, and I fully share his views, that the Chinese are definitely trying to see how far they can go with us because they want to get strategic advantage. If we do not back off, we will definitely be able to outsmart them now and in the future. The line of actual control, General Astana, was agreed upon even in 1962. They have encroached upon territory which they had not claimed post 1962, as you know very well, being a military expert. So this is very clear that they are trying to take a strategic advantage, and you are absolutely right, spot on, that this is not the time for us to back off. And finally, Vineet, I wanted to say, the Chinese, as Sumit reminded us, had always been a land power, a continental power, not a maritime power. And this is where their weakness is, and this is where we need to push hard. And this is what we are trying to do.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Thank you, everyone, for being a part of the show.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.